On Story is brought to you in part by the Alice Clayburgh Reynolds Foundation, a Texas family providing innovative funding since 1979. Story, presented by Austin Film Festival, a look inside the creative process from today's leading writers and directors. In this week's On Story, a conversation with the Academy Award-nominated screenwriter of Philadelphia, Ron Nyswaner.
And a long time ago, the great screenwriter Paul Schrader taught a class of mine, and he said, get your stories from newspapers, but not the New York Times, go to the Post. You know, get those sort of bold stories. I have found that the richness of what real people have done in life is usually much more compelling.
In this episode, Ron Nyswaner recounts the social impact of his screenplay for Philadelphia 20 years after its release.
You know, I was just so blessed to be part of this movie, Philadelphia, and I think everybody, which is celebrating its 20th anniversary, we can't believe it, this year, and everybody who came on board, I remember, you know, to work in Philadelphia, that there was we were privileged, and there was like this grace going on, and so many of the people in Philadelphia were people with AIDS, and there were actually, I think we counted 50 people, through people who have had good-sized parts, like Ron Vauder, to people who just, you know, were extras.
How are you feeling?
Feeling pretty good.
Great. Make a fist for me?
Another thing.
Once more. Gonna have to start looking for veins in your feet, sweetheart.
I think of the 50, one of them is alive today. And most of them were dead before the film was even released. So when I watch that film, I'm actually seeing a photo of like a family album of a lot of lost relatives, in a way.
Every movie is a love story. Every movie, I think, every great compelling movie has a central relationship to it. And the central relationship in that movie is between Tom Hanks' character Andrew and Denzel Washington's character Joe. By the way, in the first draft of the script, Denzel's character was Joe Napolitano. That's the cast. Joe came to us. Denzel came to us and said, I want to play Joe. We're like, you want to play Joe Napolitano? He said, no, you'll have to change the name. He said, but don't change one word. At first we thought, we're doing this movie about discrimination against gay people with AIDS, and then we have a black lawyer. And for a moment we thought, it's too complicated. It's like, there's too much potential discrimination and all this kind of stuff. And it was Denzel who said, don't change a word. I'm just going to play the part. Just change my last name. So but the structure of the firing scene, so their relationship was central. So what I couldn't do, I had to know when I was going to go back and forth. And I could only stay away from one of those characters. And that, you know, it's funny, that movie has dual main characters. If you look at screen time, there are two main characters. It's an odd structure, actually. And we do go away. You know, we spend some time with Tom, and then we go away for a while, and we spend some time with Denzel, and we keep doing that back and forth. And then, but the central relationship is there. It's their love story. In the firing story, the emotional impact is about him relaying that to Denzel. He's asking him to represent him. So that's the dramatic tension of the scene.
Didn't you have an obligation to tell your employer you had this dreaded, deadly, infectious disease?
That's not the point. From the day they hired me to the day I was fired, I served my clients consistently, thoroughly, with absolute excellence. If they hadn't fired me, that's what I'd be doing today.
And they don't want to fire you for having AIDS, so in spite of your brilliance, they'd make you look incompetent, thus the mysterious lost file. Is that what you're trying to tell me?
Correct. I was sabotaged.
I don't buy it, counselor.
That's very disappointing.
I don't see a case.
I have a case. If you don't want it for personal reasons.
Thank you. That's correct. I don't.
Well, thank you for your time, counselor.
The movie Philadelphia. That came, that's the first time I think that an idea or a theme or a subject was the first, was the beginning of a movie for me. And that was in 1988, the director Jonathan Demme, that I'd worked with before, and we were friends, called me and said, one of my very best friends has just been diagnosed with AIDS. I want to make a movie about this. It's the only thing we can do. And my nephew had just been diagnosed with AIDS. And people forget that in 1988, when you were diagnosed with AIDS, that was a death sentence. You were not going to survive, for the most part, longer than a couple of years. So we responded to that tragedy by trying to make a movie. But it took us a long time to find the story to tell within that theme. But we started with, let's make a movie about AIDS. And then where that took us to was through a lot of meetings and conversations and reading this book or reading that book and reading this article, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Finding, being inspired by a story that was set, that was a lawsuit. And realizing that the best way to tell a story about AIDS that would attract an audience is to tell it in a familiar, entertaining genre. So the courtroom melodrama. You know, it's a pretty compelling, tried and true form for telling a story. So we marry that theme, that subject of AIDS, to a courtroom drama, and created the movie that was Philadelphia.
It is up to you to sift through layer upon layer of truth until you determine for yourselves which version sounds the most true. There's certain points that I must prove to you. Point number one, Andrew Beckett is a brilliant lawyer, great lawyer.
There is a scene in it in which Tom Hanks recites the lines of an opera aria to Denzel Washington. It is, in many people's minds, it's the best scene, and somebody, AFI or somebody who does it, listed it as one of the 100 most best scenes in American movies or something like that.
The music, it fills with a hope. That'll change again, listen. Listen. I bring sorrow to those who love me.
When it went into the script, everybody hated it. There were gay executives at the studio who were like really offended because, oh, what a stereotype. Like, all of us gay guys listen to opera. Yeah. And Jonathan Demme and I just remember it was so shocking because I wrote it, just happened like that. And I was actually listening to that opera aria in my house one morning, I'll tell this story. I started crying. And my lawnmower guy I lived in upstate New York at the time, knocked at my door. And I thought he had looked through the window and had seen me. And I had this intense moment of shame. And I was thinking, oh, look at you, you sissy, sitting here crying, listening to opera. And now Russell, the lawnmower guy, whose opinion obviously must mean so much to me, has seen you. He's seen your secret. You're gay. And I realized, that's what this movie's about. And so I just wrote it. I just wrote, like, and Tom Hanks puts on this opera aria, and he gets all emotional. And what does that do to the straight guy? And, like, that's fantastic. That just goes right in. Jonathan Demme read it and said, he said, He looked up and he said, "Ron, I don't know if we can do this to an audience." He said, but everybody hated it. We had memos. People hate opera, blah, 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 blah. Can't we do a pop song? Can't we get Madonna to do something? I mean, we had a stack of memos like this, and the ones from the gay executives calling me like a traitor to the tribe. And Demi looked at me and said, "Do you like this scene?" I said, "I love this scene." He said, "So do I. Fuck them."
The characters that intrigue me are characters who don't know quite the life that they're supposed to live. That they're living, at the beginning of the story, they're living one kind of life. And there's something unsettled in them. They don't know what it is, but they know, but they want something more. Or they don't even know that they want something more. But we feel for them that they would be happy if they had something more than what they have right now. In my movie Philadelphia, it's a movie about lawyers. In The Painted Veil, set in 1925, you know, Edward Norton played a doctor. Naomi Watts played his wife. The types of people don't interest me. You know, what interests me is that the characters, that there's that something in them is unresolved. And it's something that I feel that's unresolved, perhaps in my life or in most people's lives. And that's what they're struggling with interests me.
So we went to Mark Platt. He was the head of TriStar Pictures at the time. He said to me, I'll never forget it. It was such a moving moment in my life. He said, "You know, Ron and Jonathan, there are 10 scripts out there in the development, the Hollywood world." This is 1990, early in the AIDS crisis, AIDS epidemic. So he said, "There are 10 scripts out, 10 other scripts out there right now. People are shopping around. It's about AIDS. They all have heterosexual main characters." And this is one of those executives who said to us, those bad executives, he said, "That's immoral." Mm. He said, "We're going to make this movie because this is the movie that has to be made." You know, so we had an open door. Now, Jonathan Demme made Silence of the Lambs, which was released in 1991, but they did put Philadelphia into development in 1990. There were a group of courageous people at TriStar and at Sony who really believed in the movie. And, you know, their jobs are on the line more than ours. I'd always sell another screenplay. So they really did take a risk. And then with Silence of the Lambs, it's just, both actors won Oscars. I mean, you know, the third time in history that won the 5 top Oscars. And so every actor wanted to be in anything that Jonathan was doing. But I really think that they came because it was just a time when it was so different then. You know, people just knew. The head of Sony, I don't know if he's head of Sony, Mike Medavoy, he was like the chairman. He was the person that you never saw. And one day they said, "Mike wants to give you notes on the script." I'm like, "Mike is giving you notes?" Like, that never, like Mike? Like Mike Medavoy's giving? So I went up in an elevator alone. And they said, "Just Ron." Like, Jonathan's like, "What?" And I went up in an elevator to Mike's like penthouse office. And Mike told me the story about the sculptor whose work he's been collecting that he loved, who's dead. And he said, and the guy was like, excuse me. It's an emotional time. The guy was like 32. And he said, "It's something horrible is happening in our country. Your movie has to tell America that. Now get out of here." That was his note. So they were extraordinary and heroic people.
The Federal Vocational Rehabilitation Act of 1973 prohibits discrimination against otherwise qualified handicapped persons who are able to perform the duties required by their employment. Although the ruling did not address the specific issue of HIV and AIDS discrimination.
Subsequent decisions have held that AIDS is protected as a handicap under law, not only because of the physical limitations it imposes, but because the prejudice surrounding AIDS exacts a social death which precedes the actual physical one. This is the essence of discrimination.
formulating opinions about others not based on their individual merits, but rather on their membership in a group with assumed characteristics.
Today, still 20 years later, I have met people who said, I was able to come out of the closet because of your film. I was able to tell my parents that I'm HIV positive because of your film. Your film changed my life. And, you know, that's a rare thing. And, you know, it probably won't happen again. But that was actually the great time of my life.
You've been watching Academy Award nominated screenwriter Ron Nyswaner on Story. Next up, filmmaker Oliver Kember and his short film, Puzzled.
Hi, my name's Oliver Kember. I'm the writer, director, and cinematographer of the short film, Puzzled. I was just walking past the toy shop one day, and I actually saw a Rubik's Cube in the window, and it reminded me that this is one of those things that kind of comes and goes, but it just has a place in the playground, and it's one of those classic, timeless toys that will just never go away. And so I bought it and took it home and tried to solve it, and I actually didn't get particularly far. And instead I started writing about it and thinking about the time that it came out in 1980 and what it would have meant and how it would have taken over playgrounds. And I just love the idea of the magic it would have created at the time. One of the things that I really hope that people take away from the movie is just a reminder of the sense of wonder that you have as a kid and how open you are to the world and how everything's exciting and fresh and vibrant. And I just really wanted to make a story that reminded me what it was like to be a kid, to be that excited about something again. And it's also a story about thinking outside the box a little bit. And it's a story about how sometimes the solution isn't the most obvious one. And I hope that it inspires people to kind of rethink the solutions to their own problems in a little way. Well, luckily we had the most amazing kids who came from all over England to help out in the project. And they were patient and diligent and really as professional as any adult I've worked with. And I think the thing that saved the production was just how great the kids were. We really couldn't have done it without them. Here's my short film, Puzzled. I really hope you enjoy it. Thanks for watching.
School?
Fine, thanks.
It's Friday. Have you done your chores?
Yes, Mum.
Thank you.
chaps.
What, Oscar?
I think I can do it.
What's that?
Cute.
I think I can do it.
Go on then, smart. Whatever, loser.
Peter, pass me the cube.
Oh, not this again, Oscar.
Give me the cube.
You asked for it. It's only one side. It's Oscar, miss. He thinks he can solve the cube because he got lucky once.
Show me.
Thank you.
For more On Story, check out our free podcast at onstory.tv or search the iTunes store. And get the book today, On Story, Screenwriters and Their Craft, on Amazon.
Thank you.